H2K Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing, and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys, how we are different from our competitors. 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus, one-time fee and lifetime access to classes, access to recorded sessions of live classes. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For a free demo class, visit us at h2kinfosys.com.
Okay. The rest of the people? Okay, cool, Sushil. So download the JBoss server, and once after that, just like how you have configured the Tomcat server, you just need to configure the JBoss server also by using Servers tab and select the correct version for JBoss and point to the JBoss location. Today we'll be going to deal with PJBs, so PJB won't work with respect to web containers. It needs some EJB container, and the EJB containers are available only within application server. For that reason, we need to have at least one of the leading application servers. So currently the open source one is JBoss, and we have plenty other application servers also, like WebLogic or WebSphere. But currently we will be going to use JBoss application server, and we will be going to work on the EJBs. Did you guys get a chance to take a look at the web service assignment? Click the diagram which I have sent. Did anyone verify the diagram? If at all if you guys have no issues. Actually, this is not an urgent one. You guys can practice during the weekend or next week also, but please practice this particular example, because this will be going to deal with all the scenarios, like how to make use of the complex type and how to communicate between client and server by using objects. So here, save employee details, accepts a bean. And from client, then you are going to generate, you are going to send with respect to object only. And the right side part, the business logic part, is not required for you to do any changes for that. Only thing is, you just need to add one class, which is exception class. And the exception class is used to handle the so-called exception. And here you need to write a web service interface. See the right side part, this is same as that of our struct plus a Hibernate application. No changes. So here we are replacing struct, and we are replacing the front end also, and we are just incorporating web service, and you'll be going to write the web service client, or you can test it directly from your SOAP UI tools. So only additional point is, you just need to create one exception class. So once after that, this is the request and response. Here you can see that we are sending get user data by employee ID, passing employee ID and password from the client. And you can see that the response has received with all the information from our database tables. This one, username, which has retrieved all the information. This one is related to our criteria query. So if you guys remember the from salary and to salary, and we have applied the criteria, get employee details by criteria, get employee list by criteria. So when you have specified this criteria, you can see that all the elements, sorry, all the employees got returned and displayed into a list format. So finally, this one is for saving purpose. So you are sending some details and at the server side, it is processing the request and saving the details into the database, and once after that, it is finally responding with the generated employee ID to the client. So please practice this particular web service, then only you will be able to understand web services properly. And this was related with our Log4j framework as well. So please integrate Log4j or you are developing client side code or server side code.
This is Sushil. Can I ask you a quick thing?
Yes, Sushil.
So, you know, when I write the program, obviously, you know, I try to do a lot of code tests, or I have to go back to the program that you have done in the previously in the past.
Okay.
So I think my question is really, is this something we should really not do a lot of copy paste and try to do it on our own, or it's okay to copy paste? Because one thing that I realized that if you do a lot of cut tests, then you know you don't really write the code. You just
That means you weren't familiar with the class files and the classes first of all.
Yeah, and okay. Yeah, I just wanted to hear you because I think I suffer from that where.
Yeah.
A lot of things are there on the Google and sometimes you can just search it and, you know, I mean, it's a quick way to do it, but I think it's not the probably better way to do it.
Yeah, even if you search in the Google also, normally what I prefer is, I'll just take a look at the code and I'll write it on my phone.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, okay. Copy-paste means you'll be able to understand the code, but you won't get familiar with the class names. If you type it on your own, you'll definitely get familiar with the class names and you'll be able to remember that.
Okay. Because I see that actually when you do it, you do it you really are in the flow when you do it. It's not the same case, but if we do this, all of us can do this, we can claim ourselves Java programmer. this is all the assignment for us. I think it's not a few hours, you know.
Oh yeah, correct.
Yeah. Okay, but I think it's a good diagram to see. You know, it really shows you the end-to-end flow of one process, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, I mean, this is from start to end. So this is a good diagram to see, actually.
Yeah. Yeah, after all, if you guys are able to practice this one, you'll definitely get familiar with web services. And also the error handling kind of stuff. So there also you guys are supposed to work. Just like how we have handled with respect to SOAP fault or SOAP rank 3. You can also make use of that and write in your custom exception. It won't take much time. It's just like whatever the methods that are available in the processor, you are writing those methods again in your web service and making it as available for all accounts. So the same methods, you are just specifying it here instead of business logic, you specified at this place, still it was available at this level only. It's just like interface access. Okay, let us come to today's class. Did anyone practice the web service program? Not the one which I have sent in for the assignment, but just a small program. The addition or multiplication kind of stuff. Did anyone practice? Sheena, did you get a chance? Sheena? at least try to write at least one web service program using our basic example, the addition or multiplication kind of stuff, and verify that using for PUI tool. Sandeep, did you get a chance to work on the web service program? The basic example?
Yes, Krish, I did the basic thing.
Okay. Okay, you are able to access from the client?
Yes, I was able to.
Oh, cool, good. Did you guys get a chance to verify why EJB 2.1 is heavyweight container? Will we want to deal with EJB 3.0, but you guys should be aware of at least why EJB 2.1 is this project, or why it was called as heavyweight container. Then only whatever the differences that are explained with respect to this 3.0, you will be able to understand. Please Google it for why EJB 2.1 is heavyweight container. Yes, let us start today's class, EJB. Enterprise Java Beans. We'll be going to deal with the 3.0 first, and before that we'll be going to see what are the differences and the complexities that are available with respect to the older version, that is EJB 2.1. The EJB, Enterprise Java Beans, is a platform for building portable or scalable or reusable business applications. By using EJB, you can generate components nothing but the business components. Yesterday we have seen last time we have seen about the web services business interfaces. So before that era, in 1995 and all, you can say, so during the Java release, 1990s, and once after that, those guys have developed the solid for JSP kind of stuff. So they feel that if those are only used for web applications, and they want something new that can span across the enterprise. So during the startup days, they have released EJB, which is an enterprise application or enterprise components. And once after that only, all the remaining stuff came into existence. Either you can say Struts, Spring, or the web services kind of stuff. But during the startup days, EJB was very much used. So, just like your credit card verification kind of stuff. So the credit card verification, let us take an example, credit card verification. See, all the merchants, whoever is going to bill for the client, they are supposed to validate the credit card first. So instead of communicating with the each and every bank, what they will do is they will just go to the middle layer, and the middle layer will be going to contact the bank and will be going to verify whether the credit card details are valid or not. So from the client or from the merchant, you will be going to deal with a component. The component will be going to deal with actual business logic. The merchant will be going to talk to the component. So currently those are enterprise components, because we'll be going to discuss over the web, or you can say between two different applications or the client server communication. It's not only over the web, it can be used for all the different purposes. The components are available in different flavors. We'll be going to see that what are all the flavors that are available. But for our credit card verification, currently all your banks, what they will do is they'll be going to place a middle layer. The middle layer will be going to write a component. That component is responsible to talk to the business logic and validate the credit card. Because for each and every merchant, the bank cannot provide a separate service or a separate handler to invoke directly. So that's the reason we need to have a separate component in between the merchant and the server business logic layer. So this is just like a small example. You can have several number of examples like client placing several number of bits. So whenever you went to an online shopping, or let us say that is a bidding option site, and you will be going to place a certain number of bids, and you will be going to auction for one particular item, and that will be going to reflect it into your cart, and once that item was auctioned, or if it was won by someone else, then automatically your cart will get empty. So that means on the same item here, you as a client working on that, and the admin has the capability of handling the same item. Because once the auction was won by someone else, the admin will be going to remove that particular item from your cart. So these type of strategies also will be going to use some kind of components. So currently we'll be going to use that business logic component for that particular case. And in the same way, let us say in a client server communication, client wants to send some messages to the server. Asynchronously in the sense, the client won't expect any response. What he'll do is he'll just send a response to the server, and whenever the server is interested or whenever the server is up, he'll be going to get the message and he'll be going to process the request or store the data or any kind of stuff. And this kind of mechanism also available with respect to our components, our EJB components. So what the client will do is, client will be going to push the message to a pipe. You can say just like a normal pipe. The client will sit here. Server will be going to sit here. So these two are not in the same JVM. So they can be on remote JVMs, like they can be communicated over the web, or you can say if at all if they are working on the same project, so they can be connected using the LAN. So what the client will do is, client will be going to push the message to a middleware server. And on the right side, your normal server components will be there. So whenever the client has sent a message, your middleware server will be going to receive that particular message and will be going to store that message in a file. So it will be going to store those messages. So once the server is up, let us say the server is up, it will be going to, what the server will do, the server will be going to listen to the middleware server. So the server will be going to listen to that particular pipe or channel, And if at all if there are any messages are available, then server will be going to receive those messages and will be going to process those messages. So the client server communication is very much important, because in any kind of project, it won't be going to work on a single module. It will be going to contain several number of modules, and we need a communication between different modules. So here it can be a module 1 and here it can be module 2. But what we need, we want the communication between module 1 and module 2. And if at all, if the module 2 was not up, or if the module 2 was not able to process the request at this point of time, you need to have some kind of mechanism to hold those messages. That will be handled by using a technology called JMS, Java Messaging Service. In your EJB modules, there is one specific beam that is available, which will be going to listen to this particular JMS and will be going to receive those messages. And the JMS has the option, like if at all if the server was or the your beam was not ready, it will be going to store those messages, and whenever your server was up or your component was up, it will be going to send that particular message. This kind of mechanism, it was handled by using Java Messaging Service, or else there is one other technology which is MQ. This is message queue. The current, this was not related to our EJBs, I'm just explaining for your purpose. The message queuing, it was developed by IBM and it is a paid one. To maintain MQ message queuing, there is a tool called Data Power. This is middleware communication tool. Data Power is used as middleware communication tool. So if at all if it is a big project, people will be going to use MQ, and if it is a small one and we don't want the synchronous communication, because by using JMS you can only do asynchronous communication. And if you want, the synchronous communication by using JMS also you can do, but normally people will prefer MQ if at all if it is a big project, and if you want the logging kind of mechanism for all your messages, then they'll definitely go for MQ. Because JMS, it's not at all possible to take a look at the message once it has reached to middleware server. But for MQ, you have the option of verifying the messages, and you have the option of validating the messages, and if you have, if you want some kind of data transformation, that also you can do with respect to your MQ. But JMS won't provide those many capabilities. It will be just used only for storing the message and sending it onto the server. That's the whole purpose. Come back to our EJBs. EJBs, they are business components, mainly used for developing some component, business components, like you can develop a robust application, or highly scalable business application, or you can say a reusable application. So by using EJBs, or once you have developed a enterprise Java Beam and deployed onto a server, just like how you have deployed all your servlet for JSP application to a server, your enterprise Java Beam application also will be developed and deployed onto a server. But instead of deploying onto a web server, you will be going to deploy it onto an application server. Just like your web container, which will be going to handle all the requests, all the HTTP requests, here in the application server, it contains another module, which is EJB container, which is nothing but Enterprise Java Beam container. See, EJB is a component, or you can say EJB is a framework, and it was embedded with EJB container. So both Enterprise Java Beans and EJB container will be going to called as EJB framework. your EJB container will be going to provide a lot of functionalities. Or else let us take first of all what is the difference between web server and application server. Then we'll come back and see about EJB. Until now we have discussed about servlets or JSPs or Strut framework or any kind of stuff. All the requests are handled only in terms of by HTTP. See, even yesterday also when we have used the web services, we have seen the SOAP requests are triggered by using the POST method. So your web container or your web server will be going to handle only HTTP based requests. So whenever you want to perform certain business kind of stuff, let us say you want to call a method that is available on a remote server, and you are only interested in getting the response in terms of objects or in terms of normal primitive data, then it is not at all possible by using your normal web server. Your web server can communicate only based on the HTTP protocol, or the requests are also will go only based on HTTP. And the response at the most you can receive only in the form of HTML, static page or dynamic page. And your web server can only be used as a container for servlets and JSPs, because it contains only web containers. But your application server, web server is also a part of application server. So that means your application server consists of containers, be specific, web containers and web server. And it also consists of another container, which is EJB container, which is used for handling the business mode, business components. And it also provides several services. Your application server provides several services which are not at all available with respect to your web container. See, until now your web container, what it is doing, it is just receiving the request from that line and it is creating an instance and then directly handling it over to your servlet or JSP. It is not at all doing any kind of other stuff other than receiving the request and passing it on to your servlet. But your application server can do a lot of stuff. It consists of several services. It has the capability of maintaining the transaction management, and it has the capability of maintaining the data sources nothing but until now we have used normal JDB system. So whenever you have used driver manager or get connection, it will be going to retrieve only single connection. But your application server has the capability of holding a connection pool. So connection pool means which will be going to contain several number of connections and made it available to your application automatically. So you can specify how many number of connections you want. See, the connection pool is nothing but which consists of several number of connections and make it available to your application. You can just ask the data source. So data source also just like a name. You can ask the data source to get a connection. So then it will be going to get the connection from the connection pool instead of directly talking to the database. So during the startup itself, it will be going to allocate some number of connections, whatever that you have specified in your application server. And in the same way, JNDI naming and directory interface. Java naming and directory interface. I'll show you a diagram. Yeah. So just now we are discussing about the services. So these are all the services that are available. On the top, it consists of two containers. The first one is web container, which will be used for handling all the HTTP requests, and the EJB container, which will be going to handle all your business components requests, and your Tomcat web server. This is with respect to our JBoss server. So your JBoss internally contains Tomcat.
H2K Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing, and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys, how we are different from our competitors. 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus, one-time fee and lifetime access to classes, access to recorded sessions of live classes. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For a free demo class, visit us at h2kinfosys.com.